seemed like a very interesting topic.
Well, you'll see now it's coming up.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this public seminar organized by the Center for Comparative and Public Law. Today we're very honored to have with us Professor Fiona and Londras to speak to us on a topic that cannot be more timely. Europe is not well. How resilient are European values to crisis in migration, national security, economic and political war, and other crises? What accounts for this resilience or the lack thereof? And if there is a crisis in these values themselves, is there anything that we can do about the crisis? We're very eager to hear from Professor Fiona Londras. Fiona joined Birmingham Law School as the inaugural chair in Global Legal Studies last year, following time as Professor of Law at Durham Law School and a lecturer at University College Dublin. Fiona's research and teaching are in the fields of human rights and comparative constitutional law, with a particular focus on counterterrorism. In fact, Fiona has just contributed wonderfully to a roundtable on Article 23 legislation in Hong Kong this week, the proceedings of which will be uploaded onto the web very soon, so do look out for these proceedings on the CCPL website. She is a visiting professor at UCD School of Law, adjunct professor at the University of New South Wales, and global affiliate of the Vulnerability and the Human Condition Initiative at Emory University. Fiona is the joint editor-in-chief of the Irish Yearbook of International Law and co-editor of Legal Studies, the Journal of the Society of Legal Scholars of the UK and Ireland. Today she'll speak to us on, is there a rule of law crisis in Europe?
Thank you. I'm going to stand up. Thanks very much, Cora, and thank you all for coming on Friday evening to what I am afraid is not going to be a particularly uplifting talk. So as always, I feel inclined to start with both a note of thanks and a note of apologies. So the note of thanks is to Cora and the Centre for inviting me and for hosting this lecture this evening. It's lovely to be here for the first time, to meet new acquaintances and to see some old students as well. They're not old, just used to be my students, and see how everyone is getting on. And the apology is twofold. The first is that, as I've already indicated, the content of the lecture is really pretty depressing. And the second note of apology is that as a result of both a little bit of jet lag and the fact that this is a relatively new piece of work, I may read some of this, so I might not be quite as free form or as stimulating as would ordinarily be the case. So I hope you'll forgive me that. So Hong Kong is a great place to talk about the rule of law. It's a nebulous concept, as we all know, but in this jurisdiction it has acquired an importance that is almost totemic. There are many reasons for this, of course, but at least arguably include the rule of law's construction in Western legal culture in contradistinction to rule by law, or merely invoking the existence of law within the state's governing process. And in addition to the valorization of the rule of law as a means of distinguishing Hong Kong from China, both before and after 1997, this is, of course, let's see if we can fix this microphone. Should I just not use it? Yeah, okay. Thanks. Of course, this isn't the only distinction between the two places, and neither is it unproblematic. In 1998, Chu Yu-Y wrote that the rule of law inherited from the colonizers has acquired the status of a grand narrative capable of masking its own injustices in Hong Kong, while Karen Jones has written that the rule of law became a talisman against the anticipated depredations of a post-1997 Chinese government. Of course, every nation, every state, and every polity has its founding myth and founding myths, evoking the past and attempting to lay claim to shaping the future. If the rule of law is one of those founding or origin myths for Hong Kong, it is also that for whatever we might describe as the polity of Europe. To pretend that Europe is a monolithic, a singular, or a unified entity, of course, engages another founding myth of this polity of Europe. In reality, Europe, broadly understood, is at the very least 47 member states that make up the Council of Europe, reaching from the west coast of Ireland to the east coast of the Russian Federation. It is an enormous, almost bafflingly complex, diverse, legally and politically, place. It is also, and has also, always been deeply divided. But in spite of this, over the past 70 years, the history of this thing that we might call Europe has been towards trying to create some form of polity that might have some unifying ideas or notions to try to minimize the emergence of fragmentation again. And realistically, this thing that we call Europe is really multiple Europes. At the very least, it is the European Union, the Council of Europe, the European Economic Area, the Eurasian Economic Union, the Russian and the Russian Commonwealth, among many other things. But whatever it is that we call Europe, we can say that the rule of law is important to it. It is one of those founding myths and one of the commitments or principles upon which its primary legal structures and institutions have been constructed. And so the question I want to think about this evening is whether there is a crisis in the rule of law in Europe, and if so, why that might be. As I've already warned you, my diagnosis is not an uplifting one. It is that there is, without doubt, a concept, a crisis of the rule of law in Europe. Unfortunately, there are far too many examples to offer you to substantiate this than I can do in 40 minutes. So I'm going to outline a little bit what I think of as the basic ideas of the rule of law in a European sense, the basic ideas or signifiers of a crisis, and then some examples drawn from counterterrorism in Europe, from the geopolitical instability in and around Europe at present, and finally from a tendency that is developing towards the rejection of judicial adjudication in Europe. I'm going to largely skip the part where I outline the fact that the rule of law is mentioned in pretty much all of the treaties founding these different institutions, and that the rule of law is a constitutional principle of the European Union, and indeed one of the founding principles of the Council of Europe. I will simply mention on that within Europe, the rule of law as a principle is something that is seen or presented not as merely rhetorical, but also as having some form of legal or normative force that can be applied in, for example, judicial determinations of legality and proportionality, and I'll come back to that later. Of course, it's always a little bit of a cheat in a lecture like this to say, I'm not going to get into all of the contestations about what the rule of law means. We all know that it is a nebulous and a contested idea. And so I want to build my argument on what I think we could all agree are three bare bones of the rule of law. So three minimum things that you would need, or three minimum commitments to the rule of law. The first of these is legality. The second is respect for human rights, which is not always considered a bare bones part of the rule of law, but within the European public order it is. And thirdly, reviewability of state and superstate action. Legality here is, in the sense of European law, not terribly different to what we would experience in domestic law. First of all, we expect all actions to be underpinned by legal authority, that is, to be legally permitted rather than mere exercises of discretion. The second is that they must be within the legal competence of the relevant actor, so a simple ultra vires rule, let's say, you can only do what you're legally authorised to do. The third is that the action must comply with the principle of legality in terms of certainty and foreseeability of application, for example. And the fourth is that in order to comply with the principle of legality, an action must comply not only with domestic law, but also with the state's international obligations. And that has been built in to the jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights when they talk about lawfulness in actions undertaken by member states. The second bare bones ingredient for a European rule of law is respect for and compliance with human rights. Both the statute of the Council of Europe and the jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights on the one hand, and the jurisprudence and now the treaties of the European Union on the other hand, identify compliance with the rule, compliance with human rights as a fundamental legal and in some ways constitutional principle of both of those organisations. In both cases, the human rights in question spring from more or less the same place. Sometimes it's referred to as the common heritage of the peoples of Europe, which is problematic, but probably was less problematic in the 40s and 50s when those words were first being used. But generally speaking, the European Union's courts have tended, at least initially, to look to the European Convention on Human Rights as expressing the fundamental or shared rights values in Europe. So that's in the famous case, for those of you who've had to study European Union law, of Internationale Handelsgesellschaft, European Court of Justice case, but has been well established since then. Of course, Europe is no different to most places, in as much as when we talk about complying with human rights, we really mean complying with human rights law, as determined by a set of devices or techniques such as a proportionality analysis. So for rule of law, we might say at the very minimum, you would have to comply with human rights law, even while acknowledging that sometimes something can comply with human rights law and still be unjust or still cause harm in terms of rights enjoyment. The third thing then that I would say is a minimum, part of the minimum content of the European rule of law is reviewability. So this idea that state actions must be subject to review by a domestic court or by a supranational court. And we have both European Union courts and the European Court of Human Rights under the Council of Europe to do that job in Europe for us. Indeed, at the time that the Court of Justice of the European Union first identified the rule of law by name as a constitutional principle of the European Union, or the communities as it then was, it did so partly by reference to the fact that neither the institutions of the EU nor the member states can ever escape review by European courts. So it clearly connected those ideas of reviewability with the idea of the rule of law. In order to be a member of the European public order as a state, you need at a minimum to be a member of the Council of Europe and signed up to the European Convention on Human Rights. And with that comes the jurisdiction of the European Court of Human Rights. It is now, at the start, states could opt in or opt out of the jurisdiction of the court. Now it is part and parcel of being part of the convention, and that includes accepting individual petition. So the idea that an individual in your jurisdiction can, once they have exhausted domestic remedies, go to the court in Strasbourg and complain of an alleged violation by their state of their personal human rights. And again, that cannot be escaped from. So even without getting into an enormous debate or discussion about the nature of the rule of law per se, I hope we might be able to agree that those three things, legality, respect for fundamental rights, and reviewability, are important to any meaningful concept of the rule of law in a European sense. And I'm afraid I will shortly show you that all three of those are under attack. But of course, it is, before we get too pessimistic and start to talk about a crisis, it is important that we accept and acknowledge that contestation and dispute and tension and sometimes illegality and violations of rights or being annoyed with courts are all part of the everyday rough and tumble of constitutionalism, right, of governance, of running a state. So the fact that sometimes a state might violate rights, or sometimes it might complain about a court decision, or sometimes it might act, let's say, unconstitutionally, does not per se mean that there is a crisis in rule of law. And so what should we think about or try to bear in mind if we're talking about the idea of crisis? Well, if, like me, you're lucky enough to have read lots of crisis management literature, you will know that every field of operation will have a relatively different way of thinking about crisis, organizational crisis, management crisis, all the rest of it. But here it's useful, I think, for us to think about the socio-political literature on crisis, because that is really about culture and about values. So fundamentally, Turner describes a crisis as what emerges from a breakdown in shared meaning, legitimization, and institutionalization of socially constructed relationships to become a form of cultural collapse. We think about rule of law as part of the legal culture of the European polity, something that we might be able to say is a collapse rather than the everyday tensions of governance might indicate a form of crisis. We can build on that then with the work of Jürgen Habermas. We won't get into a large Habermasian discussion because, in fairness, it's 6:15 on a Friday evening. But two things that Habermas says in relating to crisis are interesting and useful to us here. The first is that where there is a sense or a decision by decision makers that the reality is no longer effectively addressed by the status quo, then there is what he calls a rationality crisis. So if, for example, the set of legal rules and institutions that you have don't seem able to deal with the governance challenge you're facing, then it's no longer rational in the German sense of rationality. So the first step might be to say there's a rationality crisis. He goes on to say then that if these same actors claim or assert that because of that rationality crisis, new ways of doing things are required in order to bridge the gap, you get a legitimization or a legitimacy crisis. So you have a rationality crisis which can but doesn't always lead to a legitimacy or a legitimization crisis. Where those two things converge, you may then get to a situation where loyalty is withdrawn from the system as it stands, from existing institutions, rules and expectations which become questioned and challenged in a serious way, perhaps even to the point where commitment to those shared norms and values is challenged or withdrawn. And Habermas doesn't go to the point, which I would have thought was logical, of calling that a loyalty crisis, but I will, right? So we'll have these three stages: a rationality crisis, a legitimacy crisis, and a loyalty crisis. And so in the context of what we might call the European rule of law, I think we might be able to accept a claim that it's in crisis if three conditions are present across a wide range of governance challenges. First of all, if key actors assert or establish that the current way the rule of law works out is inadequate to address the reality that they are trying to govern, in other words, a rationality crisis. Secondly, if they question the normative and institutional mechanisms of the rule of law, we would have a legitimacy crisis. And if they then reject those normative propositions, institutions, and rules, either expressly or through their behavior, we would have a loyalty crisis. And I'm sorry to say that, seen in this way, in my view, all roads in Europe point to crisis rather than simple contestation, resilience, or adaptation of the European rule of law. So let me move on to some examples to try to illustrate this. And we'll start with counterterrorism, not only because it's an easy one to start with, it makes the argument relatively clearly, but also because it's a really pervasive concern in Europe, both on a regional level and nationally at present. Of course, as you all know, terrorism did not start on the 11th of September 2001, and many European states were regrettably very familiar with terrorism and forms of extreme political violence long before then. Ireland, the UK, Spain, Germany, for example, would have had a good deal more than they would have liked to of experience in that. But notwithstanding that, the attacks of September 2001 do seem to have ushered in a new phase in thinking about counterterrorism and acting in order to, or ostensibly to, counterterrorism in Europe. So first of all, states that already had pretty well established institutions and laws to deal with terrorism relatively quickly began to assert the inadequacy of those systems to deal with what they classified as a radically new form of terrorist threat, the so-called Islamist terrorism that people talk about now. So that the United Kingdom, which probably had the most comprehensive set of terrorism laws, and they had just made them permanent through the Terrorism Act 2000, reacted quite swiftly with a new set of powers and laws in the Anti-Terrorism Crime and Security Act, including a power to indefinitely detain foreign suspected terrorists without trial if they could not be deported for human rights reasons. There's a delightful irony in that. The UK also used its very powerful and influential position in Europe to argue that this new terrorism could no longer be dealt with by states alone. It was a transnational phenomenon and risk that required a transnational response. And so within weeks, not just because of the UK, but within weeks, the European Union had formed an action plan on countering terrorism, which was the roadmap that led the EU to become a place which on the 10th of September 2001 had not a single law relating to terrorism, and on the 2nd of September 2016 has over 300 laws and policies relating to counterterrorism. So a very hyperactive period of legislating. And those laws and policies themselves raised serious questions and challenges to the principles of legality and respect for fundamental rights. The principle of legality we can deal with just very briefly here to start, because there was definitely a question mark over whether the European Union had competence to make law in the area of counterterrorism, which was traditionally seen as a sovereign matter for states. Security is a sovereign matter. But it was sometimes done under a sort of commercial competence, regulating telecommunications companies, and sometimes done under justice and home affairs, and sometimes done under common foreign and security policy. So it was wedged into lots of different parts of the EU's activities to try to establish competence. But more worryingly, maybe, or certainly, were the fundamental rights implications of many of the measures undertaken by the EU. And fair enough, we're not talking about indefinite detention or torture or anything like that, but we are talking about very serious and seriously disproportionate infringements on the fundamental rights of all people within the European Union, which is quite a mass of people. So one example is the EU's Data Retention Directive, which some of you might be familiar with, introduced, I think, in 2005. The Data Retention Directive required every telecommunications operator working in the European Union to retain the telecommunications metadata of everyone who made or received or used a telecommunications device within the European Union. The metadata was then to be made available to national states' law enforcement bodies for the investigation of serious crime. Which national bodies would access it, how long it was to be retained for, and what constituted serious crime were all left to the domestic states to determine. So we ended up with 27, 28 different regimes around data retention. At the time that that piece of law was being made, all NGOs and many members of the European Parliament brought to the European Union's attention the fact that the mass blanket surveillance of all people without any reasonable cause or the need to go to a court to access that data was almost certainly a disproportionate interference with fundamental rights. But the Commission simply, that's the civil service of the Union, simply said, we consider this to be a proportionate response to the risk that the European Union and our member states are facing. But sure enough, many years later, the Data Retention Directive was struck down by the Court of Justice in the European Union as, you guessed it, a disproportionate interference with fundamental rights, including the right to privacy, but not only that right. However, one of the things that's really interesting about that is that by the time the Data Retention Directive was struck down, the claim that we could not address terrorism without a power of this kind had become so entrenched and so powerful that striking that law down created not only what states presented as a rationality crisis, we need these tools, but also a legitimacy crisis. What kind of legal regime would prevent us from protecting ourselves? And all we're doing is collecting a bit of metadata, right? There was a bit of a, this isn't a big deal, it's just a bit of metadata type of address to it. And so the response to the Court of Justice's decision in at least some member states, including the United Kingdom, was simply to introduce a domestic law to put the same obligations on telecommunications providers as the EU directive had placed on them, to characterise it as a matter of domestic law and therefore not for the Court of Justice to bother itself with, and to ignore the finding that the right to privacy, which exists even without your treaty foundation in EU law, exists also in the European Convention on Human Rights, for example, was violated by laws of this kind. So not only then were fundamental rights undermined anyway, questioning commitment to legality and human rights compliance, but the effectiveness of European judicial review was also undermined by this kind of reaction. As the vulnerability of Europe, there are other examples as well, financing and things, but we won't go through them all. As European states' vulnerability to terrorism attacks and the number of so-called foreign terrorist fighters leaving Europe to fight with so-called Islamic State continues to rise, European security narratives at domestic and Brussels or European level continue to illustrate tensions between desired security action and the basic requirements of the European rule of law. There is currently a draft directive on combating terrorism, for example, that would require all member states, apart from those who opt out, that's Denmark, the UK and Ireland, always opt out from these measures, to, yes, funnily the UK, which once saw the law, opts out, to criminalise a wide range of activities, including training and travelling for recruitment and things like this in relation to terrorism, as well as putting in place wide-ranging cooperation and coordination obligations so that what's called passenger name data, which any of you who've flown to the United States recently will be familiar with, would have to be collected, would have to be shared among the members of the European Union. Not quite mass surveillance, because it would only apply to those who are flying, but nevertheless, surveillance and data valence, as they call it, without a clear rationale. But the rule of law tensions also show themselves domestically. Two examples for now. The first is Turkey's outright descent into authoritarianism in recent months since the failed coup against Erdogan. Turkey is a member of the European Convention on Human Rights, and while it has derogated from the convention now, there is absolutely no doubt that the egregious activities undertaken by Erdogan's forces in the name of security do not comply with the requirements of derogation under the European Convention on Human Rights. They cannot be said to be strictly required by the exigencies of the situation, and they include, although are not limited to, a complete and utter routing of academic freedom, the closure of universities, the removal of judges and civil servants, the closure of schools, arrest without trial, collective punishment, indefinite detention, torture, and continued persecution of the Kurdish minority in Turkey, all in the name of security, purging the coup that threatened the republic. It seems clear that this will proceed without effective sanction from European member states and European institutions. This is not mere power politics or mere neorealism. Turkey is not only a member of the Council of Europe, but also a putative member state of the European Union. It is expected to adhere to the European rule of law, and the European states and institutions are expected to make it adhere to the rule of law. In this, both Turkey and Europe are clearly failing. We'll come back to Turkey later when we talk about refugees. But just in case we might be tempted, as people sometimes are, to say that Turkey is too particular an example to demonstrate some sort of European problem on the very problematic but not uncommon assumption that Turkey is somehow exotic or un-European, let us remind ourselves that one of the founding members of the contemporary European order, France, is currently showing what can only be described as rank disrespect for the rule of law in its response to security risks. The state of emergency in France seems endless, even though all of the facts establish that what France really needs to tackle to become more secure is not human rights or constitutionalism, but poor state mechanisms. Cooperation, intelligence sharing, policing, all failed in every one of the attacks that have been experienced in France recently, with the possible exception of the attack in Nice. They are all more appropriate targets for a claim of rationality crisis than is the law, and yet it is the law that is being attacked. So France repeatedly extends its state of emergency, it has derogated from the convention, and it applies its new security powers in what is increasingly becoming clear is an entirely discriminatory manner. In other words, it has allowed itself to descend in rapid order into the very worst of othering that panic about terrorism can usher in. To give one example, we might say and acknowledge that Muslim women in France are under particular attack for daring to manifest their multiple identities in their dress, for defying essentializing narratives of Muslim women as disempowered, and for demonstrating all of the audacity that comes with being a Muslim woman in public. They are accused of being terrorists through their dress, of dividing through religious affiliation, and they are forced to strip in public at gunpoint on public beaches. In my world, that is sexual assault. In France, that is secularism, sense, and security. As Hobbes might say, we should never forget how close to brutality all of our polities are, and how important the rule of law is in holding us back. Last week, the Conseil d'État rightly decried the obvious illegality of local laws that banned the burkini, identifying the rights of their wearers to religious belief, and the irrationality of the ban, and they struck the laws down. The court, as courts often do, tried to awaken the polity from its totalitarian thrall, but the response suggests a lack of success. Nicolas Sarkozy, likely to be the next president of France, suggested that the appropriate response would be to make banning the burkini a national law, which could then only be challenged in the Conseil constitutionnel, the constitutional court, which, as some of you might know, has a pretty abysmal record of upholding the rights of Muslim women in recent years. And so in France now, forms of religious dress worn by Muslim women are banned. Proposals that schools should be forced to serve pork are actually taken seriously, and being visibly Muslim is a cause of sharp suspicion, all in the name of liberté, égalité, and let's not forget, fraternité. Quite apart from the impacts of counter-terrorism in Europe, we might also talk, I see the time going so admittedly briefly, about the fact that the continent is experiencing a period of real instability, which is also relevant to any health check on the rule of law. One example is Russia's activities in Ukraine and annexation of Crimea in 2014. We've already mentioned that Russia is a member of the Council of Europe and thus a part of what we might perhaps ironically call the European family, and so too is Ukraine. And yet in recent years, we have seen Russia's expansionist tendencies reach into Ukraine, undermining not only international law and territorial integrity, but also disregarding Russia's obligations and the rights of Ukrainians under the European Convention on Human Rights. We can put that in a broader context of Russia taking a very aggressive posture towards international law and working very hard to build up an alternative centre of gravity in Europe to Brussels, not least through the Eurasian Economic Union, as well as its continued attempts to undermine the European Court of Human Rights. But once again, just in case we might be tempted to say Russia is different or exceptional, we can find an example in old Europe, if we want to call it that, as well. The growth of ISIS, war in Syria, and instability in its surrounding states have, as we all know, created a mass displacement of people, which in Europe we have taken for some reason to calling a migration crisis, even though these are not migrants, they are asylum seekers, and even though the vast majority of such people fleeing persecution are in fact being accommodated in the neighbouring countries to Syria, with Lebanon and Jordan, for example, experiencing real resource strains as a result of the numbers that they are giving refuge to. The truth is that what we've taken to calling refugee trouble in Europe is not a problem of refugees at all. It is a problem of sovereignty. And it has a long pedigree in EU asylum regulation. Some years ago, the members of the European Union agreed what was known as the Dublin Regulation in order to try to make sure that if somebody came to the European Union seeking asylum, their claim would have to be processed in the first EU country that they reached. Of course, this created an entirely disproportionate burden for states that have Mediterranean borders and land borders with Eastern Europe. That's always been the case, but the weight of the pressure and the injustice of that system became fully clear in recent years, with thousands of people arriving on Greek islands, queues and queues of thousands of people walking up to the Hungarian border, and of course, unfortunately, thousands of people drowning in the Mediterranean. Rather than revisit the internally agreed rules to respect not only international refugee law, but another great European mythological principle of solidarity, the European Union decided first to try an organised reallocation of refugees among member states, largely failed, and then decided the way forward was to conclude a deal with Turkey, not a treaty, a deal, so that it wouldn't be law, that would continue to displace responsibility for humanitarianism on Turkey and use human lives as a bargaining chip. The deal shows an almost complete disregard for the rule of law and is once again justified by reference to claims of irrationality and a legitimacy crisis. So people are returned to Turkey who might have arrived in Greece from there. There's a swap system. These are people, but we call it a swap system. And the return for Turkey was to be visa liberalisation, speeding up accession talks, speeding up a customs union, and up to €6 billion from the EU to help deal with the refugee crisis in Europe. So refugee law that might require EU states to just grant asylum to everybody who qualified for it was presented as irrational because, you see, we were told the numbers were too great. The resources were not available. And after all, these were not just refugees. They were Muslims, they were Arabs, and they might even have been an ISIS plot. In other words, they were no longer people, they were threats. In the words of Hungarian Prime Minister, a singularly unpleasant chap, Viktor Orban, any attempt to resettle refugees who already reached Europe would, in his words, reframe the ethnic, cultural and religious profile of Hungary and Europe and undermine Europe's, what he called, Christian-Jewish worldview. The long historical presence of Islam and Islamic populations across Europe is now nothing more than an inconvenient historical truth, of course. So instead of living up to our legal and moral duties, we created a system born of politics that undermined the system born of law. We deemed the law irrational and illegitimate, and therefore we undermined it with a grubby deal that had more to do with getting rid of the problem than it had to do with solving it. Finally, a judicial review crisis, which I'll deal with relatively quickly. So surely, you might say, there's hope. The courts must be the bulwark, protecting the rule of law and containing the worst of these urges and excesses. And of course, Europe is full of courts, domestic courts and regional courts. In theory, I would agree that courts can, should, and would be the answer, but the reality is somewhat different. It is true that often, although not always, both European and domestic courts have pushed back against these excessive and anti-rule of law measures taken by both the EU and by domestic governments. But courts are by their nature vulnerable institutions. They rely on the remainder of the state for enforcement, for resources, and for respect. Their members are appointed by other branches of the state. They are paid by the state, and their tenure is protected by the state. They are sometimes removed for failures to make decisions that governments would prefer, and while this may not be common in Europe, it is not unknown. Regional courts are just as vulnerable, if not more so. The European Court of Human Rights, for example, is woefully under-resourced, incredibly overstretched, and constantly being asked to do more and more to solve what are fundamentally political problems of a failure to respect rights across the continent of Europe. As the European Court of Human Rights is struggling to maintain support from its member states, it is accused by some of being an illustration of a rationality crisis that goes to the heart of human rights. The claim is that human rights, as protected in the Convention, prevent us from doing what we need to do to maintain the security of our state against terrorists, against migrants, often against multiculturalism. In other words, rights and human rights courts are presented as the problem and not the solution. One example, though it's not the only one, is a speech by Theresa May, then Secretary of State and now Prime Minister, who could say with her head held high and with an apparent ahistoricism that amuses me and I'm sure anybody else who grew up in an actual or former British colony, that the European Court adds nothing to our prosperity and makes us less secure by preventing the deportation of dangerous foreign nationals, so in my view we should leave, not just the ECHR, but also the jurisdiction of its court. This doesn't mean I'm against human rights, she says. This is Great Britain, the country of Magna Carta, parliamentary democracy, and the fairest courts in the world, and we can protect rights ourselves in a way that doesn't jeopardise national security or bind the hands of Parliament. The claim, as is clear from Mrs. May's speech, is not only that there is a rationality crisis in respect of the court, but that there is a legitimacy crisis. The court makes us less safe, and also the court is forcing us to change things that we have a democratic mandate to do, like in Britain, for example, not allowing prisoners to vote. The British government absolutely abhors the idea of prisoners voting for reasons that nobody can understand. Of course, this is anathema to the rule of law in any meaningful sense. The idea that a state would be able to pursue policies because they have voted in favour of them, even if a court deems them to be unlawful or to violate human rights. Law binds and constrains the state, after all, even when that is inconvenient. Surely that is what distinguishes law from other forms of power. But it looks increasingly like the British reaction will be simply to repeal the Human Rights Act, maybe to leave the ECHR and to retreat to insularity. Russia has taken a different approach by introducing an amendment to its constitutional law that would allow its constitutional court to declare that any international court judgment that was incompatible with the Russian constitution would have no domestic legal force. In other words, domestic law would override international law entirely. International judicial adjudication would be subjugated to domestic law norms, and Russian law would effectively prevail. Russia is not alone. There is now a proposal in Switzerland for an initiative referendum to introduce precisely the same provision in the Swiss constitution. So all of this makes it clear that at least some courts in Europe are operating under an implicit or explicit threat that if they don't change the way they do things, states will either walk away or ignore them. Of course, this is less easily done in domestic courts, but it's not impossible. I don't have the time to go into it, but we can talk in the Q&A if you want about both Hungary and Poland, where the constitutions have been changed in recent years to allow the government to appoint judges alone without the opposition, to pack the court and to change all of the procedural rules of the court to make it practically impossible to find against a government action. Hungary has been at this for a couple of years now. Poland is relatively new to the game, but proving particularly effective at it. And so we near the end of this sorry tale, and the unavoidable conclusion, in my view, that there is a rule of law crisis in Europe. A crisis that makes me anxious, not least because the potential responses seem inadequate. So I could come up with two possible legal responses. In the first place, we, whoever we are, could hold firm. We could just let states walk away from the European political order, or indeed expel them if they continue to reject the rule of law. And we could refuse to compromise on our principles. But I wonder what that would achieve. Too many developments in Turkey, Russia, Hungary, Poland, and elsewhere suggest that to cut these states off would be to abandon what are now our European brothers and sisters to the return of creeping authoritarianism, while what would be left, basically old Europe, plus might be able to recover its commitment to the rule of law, it would, in my view, mark the failure of the European project. Not only would some states retreat from Brussels, most likely to alternative centres of power, certainly in Moscow, maybe in Beijing, and possibly in the case of Ankara in Riyadh, but Brexit fever might lead to further fragmentation with soundings already in the Czech Republic, the Netherlands and Ireland that there may be some movements towards an equivalent exit referendum from the European Union. So the second alternative is to adjust some of our rules, to heed the rationality and legitimacy claims from these states, and to try, nevertheless, to maintain the rule of law status as a key constitutional principle. However, the sad truth is that we've already started to do this, and it hasn't slowed the crisis down. The European Court of Human Rights has all but abandoned Muslim women who want to manifest their religious beliefs through their dress. It has, for example, allowed both Turkey and France to ban Islamic headwear for women in public spaces, while allowing Italy to require schools to display a crucifix, because in the view of the court, a crucifix is not a religious symbol. What, of course, the court means is that it is not a religious symbol that is unfamiliar, uncomfortable, or un-European. The right to a fair trial under Article 6 of the Convention, for example, would be unrecognisable now to a lawyer who had been working in 1999. You don't need equality of arms anymore, it appears, to have a due process and a fair trial in Europe. And the European Court already exercises exceptional self-restraint, applying admissibility rules very sharply to try to exclude highly controversial cases, giving states an enormous margin of appreciation, particularly in cultural and security cases, and requiring under Article 35 that someone show a significant disadvantage to be allowed to bring their case. Having your rights violated, you see, is no longer significant enough to have adjudication by the European Court of Human Rights. And so I wonder how much further, or how much lower, should I say, can we go to maintain and protect a principle we call the rule of law while being able to lay claim to it in any sort of meaningful sense. To continue with these quiet, subtle, and sometimes unconscious acts of recalibration to try to stave off the loyalty crisis that the European rule of law seems to be suffering would in effect accede to the demands of states, it would require us to accept a number of logical endpoints that are simply incompatible with the rule of law, and indeed we may well end up sacrificing the rule of law in order to preserve it. And so the sad thing for me is that in many ways Europe's rule of law crisis is not only a crisis, it is also a trap. It seems to me that there is no way to resolve it without either losing Europe or losing the rule of law. Unless, there is a note of optimism, unless, somewhat ironically, we turn to the very thing that the rule of law is designed to restrain, politics. At present, there are states such as the UK and France with an historical and deep-seated constitutional commitment to the rule of law, with powerful and hegemonic positions in Europe, and with a great deal of national constitutional resilience, who are currently acting in their own self-interest, either ignorant or nonchalant about the implications of their actions for Europe more broadly. We can only hope that they can be awoken from this, their insularity, and convinced to see the risks that their actions are contributing to the slow disintegration of Europe and the return of a continent divided. The rule of law cannot just be a trope. It must be a practice, a value, and a mindset, even when, or perhaps particularly when, it prevents us from acting on will alone and forces us into legality, rights, and accountability. It is imperative that in the midst of the current crisis, we remember and recommit to that. That is, I'm afraid, the only way in which Europe's rule of law crisis can be contained. Thank you. Sorry, I went slightly over.
Thank you so much, Fiona. I'm usually very brutal, kind, but I can see that everybody is so enjoying your presentation. We have a bit of time for questions. I know that this talk is due to end at 6:30. If you have to leave, feel free to leave at 6:30. I am going to propose that we overrun by 15 minutes to allow more time for discussion. Questions?
Thank you for your presentation. I remember a few months ago, Lord Panic came to this school and speak to us on freedom of expression. And in one of the, it was before Brexit, and in one of the Q&As, he said that the court is quite powerless against the people who do not want the rule of law. And it seems that we've reached a moment where the people of Europe, in a fit of whatever, does not want the rule of law. What do you think changed in the past 10 years? Or because Europe has always been in crisis. I mean, from the 1950s and 60s, we've had the communist threat, internal displacement experience at the end of the World War II is even more serious than what we experience today in terms of migration. So what? Why was there this will to uphold the rule of law back then and not now?
Tricky question. So the first thing I would say is that I'm not convinced actually that the popular demand for the rule of law has changed, or that if we actually sat down and had honest public discussions about what the logical endpoints of all the things that we are now demanding of governments and supporting governments doing would look like, that people would want that. So one of the things I think that has changed maybe is that quite a lot of this is being done to or primarily felt by them and not by us. So that for example, we all might have had our telecommunications data retained, but we didn't stop using our phones, right? Because we thought, well, we're not doing anything wrong, so there's nothing to worry about. We all might have been living in states that had extensive stop and search powers. But if I'm walking down the street, I know that I'm not going to be stopped and searched. So really, what do I care about whether somebody else is? So that's one of the things that I think is important here, is the idea that these are things being done to other people and not to us, whoever the us is. It's also related to what I think is an important distinction between the end of the Second World War and now. And that is that this enormous displacement, which in terms of numbers, by the way, is actually not large in Europe. Like, it's not millions and millions of people turning up on European shores. Right? Like, it's quite easily dealt with in real terms. But between that and the late 1930s, early mid-1940s, is, without putting too fine a point on it, they're not Europeans. In other words, there isn't a sense that this is a failure of our continent. There is a return, a really, really worrying return of some kind of subconscious idea of, I don't know, barbarism or exoticism or something like, well, you know, what would you expect? You hear, for example, there was a survey recently,
recently in the UK, where over half of the people who responded said that they thought the world would be a better place if the British Empire still existed. Right? I mean, it's pretty extraordinary. But there is a sense, you know, what could you expect? What else is going to happen? This is inevitable, and anyway, it's not our problem. If something happens in Europe, then it's our problem. The third part of that, too many people do not think that Russia and Turkey, Azerbaijan, Poland, maybe Montenegro, Macedonia, are really European. Too many people, at least in the side of Europe where I live, think that Europe is still Ireland, the UK, they know that Ireland and the UK are different countries, France, Germany, Spain, right? So they're old Europe. And so there's just a sense that it's far away and out of sight, and it's not really our problem. You won't hear very many people talking about the fact that one European state has just annexed part of another European state. Very few people are talking about that, even though it's entirely outrageous, right? So there are lots and lots of different things going on. So I don't quite accept the premise that people don't support the rule of law anymore. But I think the issue is people don't see the connections between what happens there and what happens here, between what happens to you and what happens to me. So whether it's a failure of consciousness, or actually I think rather more sadly a failure of empathy, I suspect that that is a really big part of the issue. And another thing is unpredictability. There is a sense that these threats that we face from terrorism, everybody knows like they're more likely to be run down by a bus than they are to find themselves in a terrorist attack. But they know how to take steps to prevent themselves being run down by a bus. They can trust that the bus driver will probably stop at a red light. They can go to pedestrian crossing. They can look around and they know what a bus looks like. But they feel like terrorism is completely unpredictable. And as a result, just do what it takes. So there's a bit of all of those things going on.
Thank you for a really thoughtful paper. I was wondering whether you could say a little bit more about the role of rhetoric and the emergence of the rule of law crisis that you've been describing. And I have in mind Judith Butler's warning after the Paris terrorist attack that we need to pay particular attention to the changes in meaning in words that are traditionally associated with the concept of the rule of law, so words like rights or liberty. And you alluded to linguistic issues at various points in your paper, and I was wondering whether you think that there are particular semiotic shifts that have been particularly striking, or that we should pay particular attention to when thinking about the rule of law crisis.
Yeah, so let me start with an admission that even though I am familiar with Judith Butler's stuff after the Paris attacks, and I think she was there actually at the time, so she wrote quite a lot about it, I'm not super tippy-toppy on Butler, so I won't necessarily go into semantic shifts in the way that Butler might ordinarily think about it. But there are really serious, subtle and significant shifts, as you suggest, in meanings of concepts like rights and the rule of law that have been going on for years, actually. So when you think about something like the development literature, right? Sustainable development, the idea of international development. They talk about the rule of law a lot. We need rule of law. But what they usually mean by rule of law there is we need to know that there is a legal system that works. Actually, they often mean rule by law. Be rules that are applied to everybody and a court that can adjudicate them. If you think about things like a number of big international NGOs' rule of law indexes, it's about the same stuff. It's about predictability. Are there rules? Are the institutions? Are the institutions strong? What's a strong institution? Are the institutions strong? They mean, are they not corrupt? Largely is what they mean. So that there has been, and then you think about rights and the idea of the right to security, an incredibly important shift in the past 10 to 15 years has been the strong emergence of this idea that there is such a thing as a legal right that could be conceptualized that would be a right to security, that states would have a duty to do things to secure us. And all of these ideas emerge actually from very good places. So from the attempt to get really to a better state of affairs in the end, from the knowledge that if you securitize things, so on, you know, with the exception of this gap for the global financial crisis, the way to get something done in the last 15 years has been to call it security. So if you securitize things, you get attention, you get resources, you get political willingness behind it. So looking for a really good end, engaging quite, in a quite savvy way in what's going on, but maybe not always thinking about the fact that the rule of law in international development literature now, when I read it, for example, looks to me a lot more like the idea that the state would be effectively able to coerce good behavior than that we would be effectively able to stop unjust state coercion. So it doesn't look anything like a rule of law that I would have grown up with, you know, that I would have thought about or learned about in law school. So it's not a Butler type answer, but I hope it addresses some of the same stuff.
Thank you for your speech. I'm a Year 3 Law and Politics student here in HKU. Undeniably, there's an increasing power and influence of the four Visegrad Eastern European countries in Europe, especially in the wake of Brexit. For example, you see Viktor Orban saying that the problem is not with Mecca, but Brussels. You have Poland recently not responding to the rule of law commission's recommendations, and you have the EU presidency just rotating back to Slovakia. Do you think this is a welcoming trend for the increasing role of these four countries, especially in terms of endorsing a more conservative-led and perhaps more pluralistic conception of rule of law, in the sense that these four countries were not part of the negotiation or construction of the European project after World War II? They only acceded joint the European project in the late 1990s and the start of 2000. Does this more pluralistic conception of rule of law not reflect a more accurate reflection of Europe in the end?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question, right? Because this is, like, this is always the sort of footnote that you have to put in when you say the rule of law is a constitutional principle of Europe. Say, like, well, the rule of law is understood by this very small group of states at the time, who themselves were not necessarily rule of law champions outside of their home territories. And that as Europe has diversified, a diversity of ideas around what the rule of law might mean, require, and work like has been introduced. And it is, I would say, in the normal course of events that as you diversify any institution, you shift some of the meanings. And I guess, so in that way, I don't think that's a negative thing. Which is why I would focus on those three, well, as I said, this kind of three bare bones bits of the rule of law that one might expect should be present no matter the different, let's say, genus of rule of law that you're dealing with. This idea that there should be lawful authority, that you should comply with rights, and that state action should be subject to review, which would be effective. So you mentioned conservatism and stuff, and yeah, part of, I wouldn't talk, for example, about the internal politics of Poland and Hungary and the really drastic conservatism about the brutal suppression, in particular, of the Roma, of linguistic minorities, and of LGBTI populations in many states in Eastern Europe, when I talk about the rule of law, unless you're saying there's a right under the convention that should be complied with. Because states are at different points and have different sets of values, and it's I don't agree with it, I would prefer it to be different, but it doesn't necessarily mean there's a rule of law problem per se, right? But when you have a situation where you are seriously questioning the appropriateness of demanding legality, rights compliance, and review, then you have a rule of law problem regardless of the diversification of the membership. So I don't see it as a negative thing per se that we have greater influence from other members of the European Union to those members who formed the coal and steel community. That is as it should be, in my view. But there has to still be surely something, some essence of the rule, if it's a constitutional principle, some essence of it that we can maintain? And if not, then you see it has failed, hasn't it? And you have to let the project go in a way, and maybe go back to an earlier incarnation, which will be an ever closer union and all the rest of it, because it hasn't worked. The European Union is a liberal, you know, Wilsonian liberalism, it is a liberal institution. It exists not only to create free markets and free movement, but also in the belief that capitalism and freedom of movement, rights and law, are the means to peace and prosperity. And if Europe fragments, that means that vision, as propagated by the European Union, and at the very least requiring those bare bones of the rule of law, has failed. So that's the problem for me. Not, you know, more involvement, but the fact that it looks increasingly like that's where we're going. And I mean, that's really depressing for me, anyway.
Thank you, Fiona. That was really, really interesting. I have a couple of questions. The first is, I'm thinking of your comment about what you see. You diagnose a failure of empathy, this idea of not being able to see as connected people in Western Europe, if I can put it that way, not being able to see other parts of the European Union as being connected to them. And it made me think of Benedict Anderson and the idea of imagined communities, and clearly the way this community is imagined is smaller than the actual political and geographical sort of boundaries of the European Union. And going to your comment at the end of your talk that you see potential or hope in politics. Imagined communities by definition are constructed, and so if we're turning to politics to expand how we imagine, or how, you know, Europeans, people who are part of the EU, imagine their European Union community, do you think there should be less of a reliance on legality as a vocabulary, as the vocabulary that's used as sort of this authoritative source of belonging or legitimacy, because that seems to not have been a very persuasive vocabulary. So that's the first question. And the second is going a little bit away from what you talked about, but do you see a connection between some of the crises of the legitimacy crises related to security and rights and the moving away or the whittling down of the welfare state, which was another post-Second World War, you know, one of the sort of grand humane mid-20th century projects that seems to increasingly be abandoned? Mm-hmm.
Two easy ones then. Yeah. All right, as to the first question, whether, I mean, I guess maybe in order to enhance empathy or senses of sameness, we should move away somehow from talk of legality as a source of legitimacy. I mean, I don't think many people seriously suggest that legality alone equals legitimacy. And I guess the sort of, So not only the communities, but also the union, right, is socially constructed and has created this identity for itself, which is now, as the last question was saying, being challenged and diversified in lots of ways, but it has always been the idea that legitimacy equals legality plus, like legality is just a sine qua non for legitimacy. So certainly we need to talk about more than legality, but as to whether or not we ought to think about parking the language of legality and thinking in more imaginative ways in order to try to reframe or reimagine the communities in question. The answer is, it's a long way of saying I don't know, but it's a provocative suggestion. I'm not sufficiently familiar with the literature to really know how it might play out, but I think that certainly something in order to create a better sense of EU citizenship. Citizenship is a tricky phrase as well, but let's say this idea that we are Europeans would be really useful. So one of the, I'm not British, I'm Irish, so I'm an immigrant to the United Kingdom, although we're a special class of immigrant, we're treated very well. But one of the things that struck me during the referendum on Brexit was how few British people talked about themselves as Europeans. Mainly because there are multiple identities, of course, within the UK. You might be Welsh and British. You might be Scottish and Indian and British. You might be lots of things. And then to kind of tag European on as well might be complicated, I don't know. But immigrants always talked, including non-European immigrants, everyone I spoke to talked about themselves as European, that Europeanness was really important to them. I guess because we had, many of us benefited from lots of the privileges of citizenship, including the movement, all of this stuff. So there's definitely something to it, but I don't exactly know how it would work out. In terms of connections between security crises and the reduction of the welfare state, I mean, absolutely. I talked about founding myths at the start, like one of the fictions of the EU is that, of course, it is a welfare, that the EU is like a welfare super state as well, which is completely ridiculous when you think about what's been done in Ireland and Greece and other places in the last 6 or 7 years. But certainly the reduction in the welfare state has had some kinds of connections with the increase in insecurity in the way that states understand it. There are at least two or three ways. I mean, one is just if you think about the literature on root causes of insecurity, some of it is a sense of alienation from the state, in the sense that the state is not there to support you in your aspirations, you do not belong to your state. So I think welfareism has a lot to do with helping to build those concepts and senses within communities. That's one of the ways. The second way is that the reduction in welfare, and actually many countries, the distortion of the whole idea of education and public education has removed many spaces in which normal, everyday, democratic and personal contestation and playing around with ideas has been possible. So that, as we were saying the other day, if I have a kid in my class who says, well, I don't think that the UK should ever bomb Syria because it's completely Islamophobic foreign policy, I'm supposed to report them. And 20 years ago, I talked to them, right? I'd have a debate with them about it. So it's not just that the welfare state is reduced, but also the ideas of the public goods that come from public spaces, including education, have completely been whittled away, at least in the United Kingdom, less I know, in other states. And the third way is that when the state, this is very interesting behavior in economics research on security, that one of the reasons why people are often attracted to very brutal regimes and to forms of sacrifice that may come with them is that they create effectively quasi-states to provide welfare that the state doesn't provide. And this isn't a new phenomenon. Like, why did thousands of young men in their late teens and early 20s joined the IRA in the 1960s and 70s. It wasn't only because they were living under colonial rule, it was because the state didn't provide anything, didn't provide jobs, didn't provide education, didn't provide systemic discrimination against Catholics and nationalists, and the only entity that did provide that was the IRA. So there are all of these, so now I had an answer for the second one, not the first one, at least three ways in which those things are connected.
Could I maybe just comment as an idea that with the emphasis on human rights, legality, it's talking about the emphasis on rights rather than laying emphasis on the human aspect. If you ask the people who voted to exit in the UK, I noticed that there were a number of people that I would describe as immigrants. Okay, they feel British. They don't welcome any more immigrants. And yet, if you asked a white Anglo-Saxon, is this person British? They may well say no. And so your own sense of being British, I was born in England, I lived in England for 30 years, and I always had this sense, I feel British, but does anybody else recognize me as British? So I think if there is a very, very deep sense of you are not part of our community. You may feel you are part of our community. You may even vote in the way that a white Anglo-Saxon would vote, but you know, there's actually so much division in society. And there was a time, I think, in Europe and certainly in the UK, when people talked about pluralism, welcome diversity, but I wonder how deep-seated that really is. Culturally, we all stick to our own little groups. And I think this is the thing that prevents that feeling of empathy. And if you are an immigrant, I would hope that you would always recognize this was me or this could happen to me. And when you see that communities that have been able to live different cultures, different religions, living together, and yet something happens where that can break so easily, it's so fragile, that unless we do, and this is the problem with defining everything in terms of rights instead of defining it in terms of common humanity. If you don't say to people, this could happen to you, don't think that you are secure. You actually have to recognize that no matter what the person's religion is, no matter what the color of their skin, their sexual orientation, they probably want the same things out of life as you do. And unless you push that as a state, unless the state pushes that, it's not enough to say no discrimination, because that's just a minimum, right? It's this person is the same as you.
I think you're entirely right. I wouldn't have very much to add to it except for two things. One is, as an illustration, Birmingham, where I live, which I think is now the first majority non-white city in the United Kingdom voted to leave, including enormous parts of Southeast Asian immigrant, second and third generation immigrant population, largely on the basis of immigration. Very interesting. Quite unexpected for me. And the second thing is your point about non-discrimination and your point about rights, I think is really well made, because there is an extent to which an idea and an aspiration that we might call equality has been distorted into the idea of a legal claim to non-discrimination. And we've somehow, even when you have systems like in South Africa where there's a commitment to substantive equality and not just formal equality, the legalization of these ideas has actually resulted in them being stripped down to sort of legal tests that we can apply. We've almost forgotten that they also have a social meaning. If you can come up with a way to get a state to start to push the idea that we should care about other people who aren't in this state, you could make a fortune out of that, because the self-interest of states is often to push precisely the opposite argument. It's a real challenge. So two challenges, like legalization, as you said, and then also states' perceptions of self-interest.
I was about to close,
I just have one comment, because I think it really nicely ties up the thread based on what Gladys has just said and what Marco was asking. Right, the idea that we have dehumanized particular people, and there's a narrative out there that is so compelling that it's overpowering almost. And Richard Rorty has a very interesting proposition and theory, which he calls justice as a larger loyalty. And what's fascinating about his work is, how do you get from that point where you start to build loyalties among people, where you then identify justice as being concerned with what happens to the people that you feel loyal to? And how do you establish that loyalty? And I think it brings home the point that you're driving at, which is the fundamental importance of public and educational spaces where you learn how to dialogue with people who are so fundamentally written off as different to you, because you then learn that that narrative is itself corrupt or problematic, and then you can start to cultivate feelings of empathy. And democracy today is not being practiced in that way, no matter where in the world you look at the moment. So how do you operationalize this notion of loyalty? For me, at least, is a very attractive starting point.
I don't have an answer, but
it's a comment.
Yeah, it's great.
Well, it's been really stimulating. It's fascinating. Thank you so much, Fiona. Please join me in thanking you. Certainly, I agree that politics is the ultimate solution. We lack the political will to work with the consciousness, as you say. But I think there's a value in thinking about how laws and institutions could be reformed as well. Because, well, there's a very crude analogy to constitutionalism in the national context. People are shortcuts. We think about our own interests, we think about national security, we think about rights. We can't empathize with people who are not us. But if we have judicial review, very effective enforcement of human rights laws, constitutional values, then the law and institutions can help to maintain that consciousness and remind people of that consciousness, or lead that consciousness. So, raising that consciousness so that we could have those effective enforcement institutions is of course, the ultimate question. But there's value in thinking about laws.
I'm not badly, don't worry.
Thank you for staying till the end. Thank you for your contribution.
Celebration of individualism and difference. You are fascinating to me because you're different. Not because I am the kind of person who does not exist.
It can only solve so much. But you might know that the foundation is very interesting,
which is different, which is individualism, which is the ability to see that we're different.
In some ways, very what is it like to solve single things? But the one change is the same thing of the gender rights. They only very concerned about the fact that they have always made teachers who are short. So they're very, very conscious about racial harmony, yeah. And they actually start
absolutely.
Between the different social
I don't know that we.
It's interesting though that the
and they don't talk about it.
And if you didn't have the means to bring the requisite diary, you would have been a sister. And the sister is to be a fun So, I mean, there was massification, discrimination, no sense of that, just because they were
trying to get Eric. So, Eric, I'll talk to them. Yeah, he's a
You can always, always find another way out to it instead of empathize.
Unfortunately,
that's true. Fiona, Mark and I decided that the future is it's not finding sameness, but in recognizing individuality, difference, and being able to celebrate.
It's a wonderful talk, and how much it covered. It's very thought provoking. It's very terrific.
You must be completely
worn out. I am exhausted.
I'm Chester, by the way.
You're Chester.
Yes, I think Cordelia
mentioned. She did. I have to admit, I don't remember you. Were you in my tutorial group?
That's the thing. I don't think we spoke. I think we might have spoken once or twice in context of my dissertation, because I did my dissertation on counterterrorism.
Right.
I was under Professor O'Donoghue.
Oh, right.
If you work with her. And I think we might have met once or twice.
Okay.
But yeah, I just want to say, I'm a huge environmental worker, and I never got a chance to say that before
I
graduated.
That's really, really kind of you. Thank you.
So,
you're going to come tomorrow, right?
Yes, I'm glad I met Cordelia, because she mentioned you were coming to Hong Kong in some sort of guest lecture capacity, so I thought I'd come as well.
That's really kind of you to come. I'm looking forward to tomorrow.
Oh, definitely, yes.
And we'll have a good chat. Are you studying here now, or?
No, I'm currently studying in Hong Kong. I'm doing my PCL with Cordelia, actually, in City U.
Oh, you're in City.
I think Cordelia, she did an LM issue.
Yeah, she did.
Okay.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Okay, right. Awesome. I'm actually impressed if I moved to the University of Birmingham.
Yeah.
Okay, so when did you change the school back?
Last summer.
So
a year ago.
Yeah, I've actually quite a lot of questions I want to ask about the nature of your speech, definitely. actually the fact about the rest of Europe, so I suppose I can see it as a where it's like less rush, I suppose.
Yeah, we'll have to talk about it tomorrow.
Okay, I've got
is that okay?
Yeah, that's lovely.
Right.
Again,
I'm
thank
sorry,
you for your time.
I went on far too long. But
oh, no, it was great.
Good.
Hey, thank you for your
good.
Time.
Good, I'll see you tomorrow, 1 o'clock, right?
Right.
That's
yes.
Okay, that's the
right.
Thing.
See you then.
Oh, I've got heaps.
Shall we turn this machine off? No?
I think it's fine. I think someone will do it. But
you mean?
Yeah.
So are you teaching the medical law?
Next year,
just in case.
Are there a number of compulsories?
Yes, there are four each. Does he think we're going to wait?
She's talking. He told me he's coming up.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah,
wait.
Yeah, there were lots of people. On a Friday evening.